fill my lungs with sweetness, and you fill my head with you. Shall I write it in a letter? Shall I try to get it down? Oh, you fill my head with pieces of a song I can't get out. Can I be close to you? Ooh, ooh. Can I be close to you? Ooh, ooh. Can I take it to a moment where the fields are painted gold? Trees are filled with memories of the feelings never told. When the evening pulls the sun down and the day is almost through, oh, the whole world is sleeping, but my world is you. Can I be close to
I wanna find a home and I wanna words I have to say may well be simple, but they're true. Until you give your love, there's nothing more that we can do. Love is the opening door. Love is what we came here for. No one could offer you more. Do you know what I mean? Have your eyes really seen? You say it's very hard to leave behind the life we knew. But there's no other way, and now it's really up to you. Love is the key we must turn. Truth is the flame we must burn. Freedom, the lesson we must learn. Do you know what I mean? Have your eyes really seen?
Good morning, and welcome to this very special time together. Will you please turn in your order of service to the last page? We will sing a piece called Covenant, while the family wants to. I will play it one time through, and then please join in singing.
Thank you. Welcome. I am the Reverend Jill Schwendeman. I welcome you to White Bear Unitarian Universalist Church. This congregation and this building were beloved to Christine and to her family. Years ago, I was youth director here and got to know the kids, and Christine actually came to a youth event or two, and so I got to know her just a little as well. I want to begin by offering condolences, deepest condolences to the family, to Jim McMahon, to Renee and Thomas, to Larry, to Christine's sisters, Colleen, Patty Ann, Michelle, Peggy, Elaine, Mutzi, Julie, Lorena, and Elena, and to her brothers, Tom, Dan, Ron, Paul, Frank, grandchildren, Jake, Samantha, Jessica, Maddie, Grace, Charlene, Lillian, Emmett, and Lucy. Grandchildren, Eris and Xander, numerous partners of the above, cousins, nieces, nephews, aunts, uncles, and many friends. You have a huge and wonderful family. What a blessing. For the family, I want to welcome everyone who is here today, who took time to share in this time, and I thank you for being here with them. Later in the service, you'll have a chance, which I hope you'll take, to come up and share a memory, no matter how small or big, about Christine, and we will welcome that. Afterwards, we'll have a luncheon. For now, we're going to begin with a reading that's by Renee herself. It's in two parts. It's called Fears and Antidotes to Fear, and Renee will read it, her daughter.
Thanks, everybody, for coming. It actually is something that my mom wrote. I never saw it until after she passed, and I found it. Some of you I've shared it with. I've shared it many times, hoping that I could do it here without crying, so I'm gonna do my best I can. But crying's okay. And then let me just preface it with that. She, most of you know, dealt with a lot of anxiety, so I think this is about a period of time where she was really very anxious, and the antidotes for that anxiety, and it's beautiful. Warning, when I first read it, I was like, no, the first part is kind of grim, but she comes out of it, so I'm gonna let you know that. My fear has been one of fear. I fear that no one can stop the pain, that I will live endlessly in pain. No one to comfort me, no one to make it go away. For no one has ever made it go away. I fear the aloneness of pain, a thing that no one can share with you. I like the aloneness of living. It is only the pain that frightens me. I fear lack of purpose, not enough to do. My fear is palpable, gnawing. It eats away at my stomach. I fear that no one will listen to me, that I am mostly disregarded as an eccentric, a little girl in an old woman's body. I fear censure most of all. I only want others to praise me, agree with me, honor me, respect me. I fear that I will be my mother, that she will live on in me in all of the worst ways and none of her good ways. I fear that I have not been good enough at mothering, at daughtering, at sistering, at friending. I fear that my selfish fears will be the cause of my demise, that people are already sick of my lack of giving, sharing, or walking in their shoes. I fear lack of forgiveness. I fear myself. I fear that others will hurt me and that I will die lonely, depressed, and afraid that no one cares that I will die. I fear my kids will be relieved that I am gone once I'm gone. I fear that I have not done enough good in this world and that I will have to come back and do it again. I'm scared of not being in control. I'm scared that I will control too much. I'm afraid that I am hard to look at. The sight of me makes makes some people sick. I'm afraid of the fear, and I'm afraid of the fear. How do I keep the fears at bay? I remind myself, I am a children of the universe. I have a right to be here. And whether or not it is clear to me, no doubt the universe is unfolding as it should. I'm a beautiful prism of rainbow colors, pink and yellow and blue and lavender and peach and mint green. I am only housed in this body of scars. I'm here to learn deeper meaning. And without this body, I would have a much harder time learning what I needed to. My children are strong and beautiful and good in some small way because of who I am and how I mothered them. When I see what wonderful and wise parents and lovers and friends and spouses they've become, I need to remember that they got some of that from me. Some very small part of my goodness in me was handed on to them. I have been very fortunate to have walked through the valley of shadow of death more than one time. I keep coming back because there is love here and warmth and goodwill. Although humans can be cruel, there are not many who would willingly hurt another soul. It is the paranoia gone rampant in our society which tells us to fear one another. We can live in the faith and the knowledge that we truly all are one. Individual parts of the whole. I curl up in my little house wrapped in a raggedy pink blanket that I have had over 30 years. I sit in the sun whenever possible. I eat chicken noodle soup, the cheap Campbell's kind. And I sleep. And I'm usually able to calm myself with the conviction that when I am rested, I am better able to deal with the fear. I make lists, pros and cons, decisions or actions that I can take. I analyze. I drive around, around and around. I run on the treadmill. I go see a scary movie, fight fire with fire. I cry and I pray. And I eat. I take deep breaths, or sometimes just remind myself to breathe.
Your soul to bleed. Some say love, it is a hunger, an endless seeking need. I say love, it is a flower, and you, its only seed.
Well, if I survived that, I think I could survive just about anything, right? I haven't heard a line in that song that didn't make me cry, you know, for the last couple of weeks. For those of you who don't know, my mom loved that song. She loved the music. She wrote it all out on a big piece of parchment in calligraphy, the whole song. More than any other song, that song makes me think of Mom. I spent a long time writing out what I was going to say here, and I got all done with it, and I realized that no amount of writing for me, no amount of thoughts or words could even come close to really giving you a full picture of my mom. What I thought was, I'm going to give you a bigger picture of my mom. But she spent 73 years writing that story. Who am I to try to summarize it in a few words? So let me just start with what I wrote. Maybe I can hold it together. I appreciate the girls singing that song. Although I think in retrospect, maybe I shouldn't have gone out next after that. So there's so much that I can't control, least of all, the passage of time and the way it erodes the lives of us all. It can be hard for me to avoid despair at the inevitability of loss of those that we love, the final goodbyes, spoken or not spoken. I've been dreading this event for as long as I can remember. Nobody cheats death. no matter how strong or wise they are, no matter how much they love or are loved. We don't really choose how or when we ourselves pass away, let alone the others that we love. But even though I've dreaded the day that I would have to mourn the loss of my mom, I've been looking forward to presenting to her this one last gift. These words. I can tell you her story, or at least the parts that I know, that you might know her and love her a little bit more. My mom had a lot to say in life. Some of it she wrote down, some of it she passed along to us. She wanted to be remembered. So mom, as I promised your mom the day she died, I promise you the same. I will never forget you. So here's a little bit of her story from my memories and those of others who shared a part of her life. Mom was born in St. Paul in 1949 to a 16-year-old unwed mother, Muriel McMahon. Mom's biological father, Tom Trost, did not marry Muriel, but instead his friend, Jim McMahon, did. And he adopted my mom and raised her as his own. I don't know if Papa is able to watch the stream right now, but if he is, hi, Papa. Some of Mom's earliest memories were of a train trip to move to California. Her first sister, Colleen, had been born by then, and her second sister, Patty, was born while they lived in a small California trailer home. Later, the budding family of five returned to Minnesota by car and moved to Jim's parents' house. Mom liked it there because she received so much love and care from her grandparents, her aunts and uncles. By her own account, Mom was spoiled by the affections of so many caregivers at home. When my mom was five, she accidentally started her dress, along with herself, on fire. By the time nearby adults were able to extinguish the flames, she suffered second and third degree burns over more than 60% of her body. Who can say now how much better she would have been with today's medicine, but her survival with the medicine of the 1950s was nothing short of a miracle. She stayed in the hospital and didn't return home for 13 months. She'd undergone numerous skin grafts from other parts of her body to replace the skin that was burned beyond healing. Being burned and hospitalized took the place of kindergarten, she later recounted. So she started school midway through first grade. She wore obvious scars for the rest of her life, nearly 70 more years. But the physical scars turned out to be the lesser harm she suffered from the burns. As far as she remembered, she didn't receive any treatment for the emotional scars that she also carried on the inside. Later in life, she was diagnosed with PTSD, a condition that hadn't even been named. But in those days, people bore their burdens and did what they needed to do to survive. Jim and Muriel had many more kids, six more daughters, and one son to be exact, all in the space of a handful of years. As the eldest sibling, Mom was expected to take care of her younger siblings, and she did. Jim said that as a teenager, she complained about it sometimes. Honestly, who wouldn't have? But he told her that she would just have to do it because she was all that he had. She recalls being more than a little resentful of having to care for her younger siblings for as long as she did. She was expected to not only be a care provider for them, but also a good role model. Even though she started school a year and a half behind her peers, she was the oldest and the smartest. But for her, this praise wasn't enough to counter the unfairness of her friends getting to hang out or go roller skating when all she got to do was care for her little sisters, all of whom drove her crazy, in her words. But it wasn't all bad. Her brother Frank, the last of her siblings, was born. By then, Muriel was 27 years old and had borne 8 children in 11 years, and had understandably nearly lost her mind in the process. My mom wrote this: Frankie was born when I was 11, and he was my pride and joy. I guess after 6 sisters, having a little brother was novel enough for her to tolerate helping raise one more sibling without too much complaining. When mom was in 8th grade, Muriel was committed to Hastings State Hospital for 6 months, and as a consequence, the McMahon family was split up. The school-aged children stayed home, and when Jim worked, Uncle Mike slept the night with the kids. The 3 preschoolers went to live with aunts and uncles during that period. Mom's only regret was that they took away Frankie, my baby, she said. But when Muriel returned, they went back to life as it had been before. Mom turned out to be pretty bad at following rules, and was at times stubborn and defiant, but she was very intelligent, a great student. Worried that public schools wouldn't give her the best education, Jim and Muriel enrolled her in Archbishop Murray Memorial High School, a Catholic school, her freshman year. She made many girlfriends there, most notably Candy Einott, Jackie Peterson, Margie Mangine, and Joellen Luger, with whom she shared her lunch table, and they remained connected over the 50 years that followed. Candy shared some thoughts and recollections with us about my mom's high school days. Mom was small and feisty, perhaps a fitting compliment to Candy's tall and shyness. They took their English classes together in glee club because they loved to write and sing. They were also on the school newspaper, the Mitre, as seniors, where Mom did much of the writing. Of all the girls' rooms in the house, Mom's was the only private bedroom with a door, and she reportedly used it often. It was a relatively enviable room at the time, with all her sisters having to share the rest of the basement, and her brother being the only one with a room upstairs. I remember that room. It was very small. No windows, fire trap if there ever was one, but she was the queen of that castle, I guess. Mom and Candy would stay up late on the phone, with Mom hiding from her parents under the stairs. They would analyze and philosophize, or talk about fears and frustrations, loves and heartbreaks, and family. Mom is also credited with hosting the first boy-girl party of her group of friends, where her parents rolled up the carpet in the living room to use it as a dance floor. When Mom was 16, she learned she'd been adopted by Jim McMahon, and that their family friends, the Trosts, were actually all part of her extended family, which effectively doubled the size of her known relatives. She did her best to reconnect and stay connected with them all. My mom had started dating at 15, and by the time she was 16, she was dating my dad, who went to Hill High School, the boys' counterpart to Murray. After high school, Mom started college at the University of Minnesota. She was 18 and still seeing my dad when they found themselves expecting a baby. They were married before Renee was born in 1968. After Renee was born, Mom decided to have another child so Renee wouldn't be an only child. While Dad was involved in the producing of Renee's sibling, he wasn't involved in or aware of my mom's decision to have another one so soon. But 15 months after Renee, I came along in 1969. You could say that I'm a product of my mom's independence, or maybe disobedience. Nevertheless, Mom said Dad was happy to have me when I did arrive, and I'm glad too. But my parents as a married couple was a short affair. Dad's more Catholic view of marriage, and more likely his first marriage to the bottle versus Mom's liberal-minded, independent intelligence, was a mismatch that oil and water would envy. They divorced when Renee and I were too young to remember them together. Mom took sole custody, and for a few years, it was just the three of us. Possibly the earliest memories, my earliest memories of my mom, were of accompanying her to the U of M campus for a lecture. Even with the duties of single motherhood, Mom was ambitious enough to continue her education to enrich her life and better ours. We shopped the local co-op, the West Side Co-op to be exact, and it was nothing like the genteel health food chains of today. It was about the size of a gas station, and everything was sold right from the bin. We didn't get Captain Crunch or even Raisin Bran. We got wheat germ, often the unsweetened kind. We got granola sometimes too, in bulk, of course. When we had bread, it was whole grain, not the silky white bread that our friends from school enjoyed. We hadn't even seen the stuff until then. It looked like styrofoam. Even the health nut, ever the health nut, Mom reportedly even stole vitamins for us too. In those early years, we were pretty poor. Mom waited tables and tended bar. I can remember how we'd celebrate when she'd gotten a few extra dollars or one astonishing $20 tip from a generous customer. She'd come home with a steak for dinner, one steak for us to share in celebration of her windfall. She ultimately got her teaching degree in 1978, but she was only offered full-time teaching opportunities outside of the Twin Cities. So instead she took a substitute teaching job, but found that being a substitute teacher to teenagers was more than her 4'11" stature could handle safely. Now I'm gonna fast forward over some stuff. Think of this as a few quick bullet points to cover the period of about 1975 to 1987. Mom had a bad second marriage. She picked up a bad habit. She had a bad car crash. She lived a destructive lifestyle. She earned a little time to think about her past mistakes, but she survived it. And at least one good thing came from that period. She met Larry Windish in 1975, and I don't know much about their lives together in those days, but their meeting was the seed of a loving relationship that was sprinkled in here and there through the rest of Mom's life. Larry was there with her until her last breath. So 1987 brought my mom her first grandchild, Jacob. His arrival was for her a reason to turn her life in a better direction. She began her long journey to freedom from chemical dependency, and she actively sought to understand herself and reconcile her past with her present. As she got healthier, her life began to stabilize. She said that she'd forgotten too much of what she'd learned to try again at being a teacher, but she found her way out of waiting tables and driving cab into a career in market research. She first worked for a local private research firm and then later for the Minnesota Department of Transportation. In 1995, she bought a little one-level, two-bedroom house in North St. Paul. It had a big yard where her procession of pets could roam and where she could garden and entertain company in the sunshine. She still had numerous health problems, including novel after effects from her burn scar tissue, neck and back problems from her wild and crazy past lifestyle, liver, stomach, and other internal health issues, and a normalized level of anxiety and depression related to her PTSD. But she kept on chugging along. The number of her grandchildren grew to 9 in 2014, and we added 2 great-grandchildren on the same day in 2017. She spent time with them all, and she took time to get to know, understand, and love them, and at her request, they all called her Grammy. She lasted at MnDOT long enough to earn a pension, and she retired about 10 years ago into her garden in her Farmtown farm on Facebook. She could be found all hours of the day and night tending her own farm or the farms of her large community of online friends. About a year ago, she started having health problems that would eventually overcome her. There were many ups and downs, but the ups became fewer and farther between, and the downs kept getting lower. She spent her last days, December 3rd and 4th, among many friends and family. And in the afternoon of December 4th, we put her in bed where she went to sleep for the last time. Mom, we love you and we miss you, but we will never forget you.
Carla Rains would like to share a memory. Carla is one of Christine's dearest friends. Carla? Oh, gosh. Thank you for allowing me to speak. Chris was so dear to me. We started as friends. We started as coworkers and we became fast friends and we bonded around family. Learning about you, Jake, when you were born was the same time my daughter was born. And she had so much love for family and all of her grandchildren. And while I knew her as a colleague, her love for her family was so deep that I feel I know all of you. You meant everything to her. Chris and I worked together at MnDOT. We actually worked together 3 different times, but our most joyful times was when we worked at the Metro Division over off County Road B2 for the Department of Transportation for the Metro Division. We had a grand time. Our office was in the basement. They didn't quite know what to do with us, to be candid. We were these 2 women, really in an environment of male engineers, and we were thinking we were saving the world with consumer research. And people would often come in and tell us to kind of keep it down, but we really did have a lot of fun, and we did a lot of path building, and we made, we think, a little bit of a dent in helping the citizens of the state know that, you know, the DOT was there to serve their needs. What I remember most about Chris is just the absolute joy she brought to the office. She had this attitude that was, everything was meant to be, good or bad. If it was difficult, it was a lesson she was there to learn, and she talked about the lesson and the beauty of the lesson. If it was good, it was thanks to the universe. So it was really powerful to me to witness that mentality and that approach to life. And I will forever be grateful for that. One of our grandest moments I'll share, which was a little bit of a scheme that I think encapsulated a lot of who Chris was. Chris, she had, in addition to her zest for life and her way to look at the world with such joy, that when I knew her, that was how I experienced her. And in about the mid-90s, there started to be a pattern of international exchanges.
of some of the Nordic countries. We started seeing teams of engineers traveling over to Finland and Sweden and sharing their expertise, obviously having the same climate. They had a lot of information to share back and forth. Well, Chris and her adorable activism element of her personality said, there are no women going. There's no one talking about consumer research. They're just talking about engineering practices. And she goes, I think we should change that. I said, okay, how are we gonna do that? She goes, well, I'm gonna start emailing some of these people over in Helsinki that she'd gotten some names from internally. And I said, well, okay, well, I'll work this end here of management. And to our joy, about 3 weeks later, she was on a flight to Helsinki to go share business practices about market research, you know, equipped with all of her presentations and stories. And they loved her. They loved what they shared. And we heard such positive feedback about what she did when she was over there. And she absolutely enjoyed that trip. Little side note is she had also intended to go see Ireland. She says, you know, while I'm in Helsinki, I'm going to take a side trip to go see Ireland. She said she always wanted to see Ireland, so she did. She took a side trip and she came back with so much joy and enthusiasm for what she saw in that country, the pictures, and she was just so passionate about it. I'll always remember that. And then the day she returned, she came in with this big box and I wasn't sure what was in it, and it was one of those very large, authentic wool hand-knit sweaters that she brought back for me, and she brought back one for herself too, which we laughed. I think the two of them must have weighed as much as a small Volkswagen, but she brought those back and we wore them with pride, and mostly because we were just so delighted and proud of how she served the DOT and how she represented us and how we manifested that to happen. Anyway, I love Chris. I will miss Chris dearly. I thank you for the opportunity to share this memory, and bless all of you.
Now I'd like to invite anyone who would like to come share a memory with us, big or small. Anyone?
My name is Phil Ethier, and my wife is Susan Ethier, and former Susan Gurney, and we're also here with my daughter Elizabeth Ethier. We met Chris at that food co-op on the west side. That's where we first came across her, and Susie was a manager of the food co-op for a long time, and we had a lot to do with Chris, and she became a dear friend to all of us. Susie affectionately called her Chrissy Mac. Well, many of you have seen the 1966 American animated television special, Dr. Seuss, and How the Grinch Stole Christmas. There's an iconic moment in that August tale when the disillusioned Grinch reaches out and grabs his faithful dog, Max, who's swinging from his leash, and demands to know why the Who's are singing. Chris had bought a Saturn car. She had struck up an acquaintance with a publicist for Saturn, whose name I've long ago forgotten. What the heck, I'll call him Max. The local Saturn dealers had agreed to sponsor a St. Paul Saints baseball game at Midway Stadium. Max was the Saturn liaison for the festivities. Every year then as now, the Saints obtain a young pig as a mascot and give it a topically humorous name. Max asked Chris to be the pig escort. Chris invited Susie, Susie's mother Lois, and me as her guests. We went to the ballpark and reported the staging area under the concrete grandstand on the third baseline. We got our special Saint/Saturn t-shirts, and we're photographed with Madonna. The Saints liaison pointed to the 2/3 height door at the base of the grandstand that led to the field and explained to Chris her mission. She produced an outsized white baby bottle with a black tube attached to it. You will take the leash and walk the pig to the mound, then feed him the milk. He may not be interested in cooperating, but be firm and friendly. Don't forget to smile and wave to the crowd. Chris stared at her. Then at the bottle. Then at the door leading to thousands of cheering fans. Then at the bottle again. Out of the corner of her eye, Chris spied Max standing near her. She did not turn her head. Her arm shot out to its full length. Her hand felt its mark. Her fingers curled firmly around a wad of Saint Saturn t-shirt. Pulling herself up to her full height, she reeled Max's face down to meet hers and delivered her icy message. You told me all that I had to do was walk the pig to the mound. After releasing Max, Chrissy Mack beautifully fulfilled her mission as the pig escort to the tumultuous, thunderous applause of the assembled multitude. Chris, you did that friend thing really well. Thank you.
Other memories?
My name is Heidi. I call her Grammy, and my son calls her Gigi. I remember my very first time I met her. I told Renee, and Jake and I told Renee, I hope you're sitting down, because I'm pregnant. And then a lot of stuff happened, and Grammy took me and Jake in, and I was pregnant. And it was just the kind of woman she was. She was amazing. She loved so much, and she was so kind. And then when Xander was born, she was right there. And I remember her holding her and him and looking down at him, and she said, that's the most beautiful baby. And now Xander used to go over to the house, and he'd always want to watch Forrest and Jack. And he always had fun, and he would always say, Mom, let's go to Gigi's, walk Forrest and Jack. And he'd be so happy, he'd get out of the car and he'd run right to Grammy and give her a big old hug. And then he'd go for the dogs. Then when I got pregnant again, she was right there making sure I was okay. And she would text me almost every other day asking me, how am I doing? How's the baby doing? And unfortunately I lost her, and there, right there again. She was right there, asked me every day if I was okay, and it meant so much to me because she was there, and I loved her so much, like she was my grandma too. And I will always miss her, and she was just so amazing.
Anyone else? We have an addition to our service today, and that is that young Lucy will be singing Memories by Maroon 5.
Yeah.
Here's to the ones that we got. Cheers to the wish you were here, but you're not, cause the dreams bring back all the memories of everything we've been through. Toast to the ones here today. Toast to the ones that we lost on the way, cause the dreams bring back all the memories. The memories bring back you. There's a time that I remember when I did not know no pain, when I believed them forever and everything would stay the same. Now my heart feels like December when somebody say your name, cause I can't reach out to call you, but I know I will one day. Hey, everybody hurts sometimes, everybody hurts someday. Hey, hey, but everything gonna be alright. Corners always and say, hey, here's to the ones that we got. Cheers to the wish you were here, but you're not, cause the dreams bring back all the memories of everything we've been through. Toast to the ones here today. Toast to the ones that we lost on the way, cause the dreams bring back all the memories. Memories bring back you. Do 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 do. Memories bring back you. There's a time that I remember when I never felt so lost, when I felt like all the hatred was too powerful to stop. Now my heart feels like an ember, and it's lighting up the dark. And I'll carry these torch for ya, that I know will never drop. Yeah, everybody hurts sometimes, everybody hurts someday. Hey, hey, but everything gonna be alright. Go and raise our voice and say, hey, here's to the ones that we got. Cheers to the wish you were here, but you're not, cause the dreams bring back all the memories of everything we've been through. Toast to the ones here today. Toast to the ones that we lost on the way, cause the drinks bring back all the memories. The memories bring back you. Do 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 do. Memories bring back you.
This is a poem that Grammy loved. Did she write it? I'm not sure. No, it was just a poem she loved. It's called I'm Enough. I'm enough just as I am, unfinished, imperfect, uncertain of the road I choose, yet certain that I must continue. I cannot go back. I'm not enough for some and too much for others. I struggle with myself. I wrestle with fear. I avoid the parts of me that are dark and unavoidable. Yet I want to hide no more. I am alive, I know, because I feel. In my eyes, I am damaged, hurting, healing, in need of improvement. But in the eyes of God and in the place where grace abides, I know I am enough.
How amazing to have all these grandchildren doing their thing here. Beautiful. As I listened to Tom and Renee's stories about Christine and read her words and thought about her life, I came to understand that she was a gifted person, gifted in mind and in spirit, in creativity, in gumption, in intelligence, and gifted, most important to note, in family and friends, all of you. She was gifted in her capacity to love and to be motivated by love despite the struggles, the significant struggles she experienced. She drew strength from love, and she had a vision of loving and being loved just as we are, just as we are. She wanted you to take that home today. And it's clear she did, because she gathered throughout her life poems and hymns and did her writing. She prepared for her memorial for years, the kids tell me. I hope we're doing right today. I think we're doing right today by so much quoting her and trying to catch just a glimpse of her big mind and big spirit and her hopes, her true and abiding hopes for how she wanted her family to take in her life and learn from it and be loved and feel loved. Her life was hard. She was not perfect, but she fought hard to be healthy and whole. She asserted and lived by the truth that in the eyes of God and in the place where grace abides, I know I am enough. Wow, that's the greatest lesson for each of us. And it's the hardest, let me tell you, it's the hardest lesson for human beings to learn. In the eyes of God and in the place where grace abides, I know I am enough. Christine's parents both died in her 60s. Maybe she prepared for her memorial because she thought that would be her fate as well. Or maybe it was the result of being a survivor of addiction. And before that, the terrible childhood trauma, the burns. Christine was not only not helped in her childhood, teachers dragged her around the school and said to other children, "Don't play with fire." Used her as an example. Horrible, horrible. There weren't child life specialists then as there are at children's hospitals now, and there was no counseling for this. Later on, she was part of a video made by Gillette Children's Hospital where she had received care, and this helped her some, right? Talking about PTSD. Renee, you called her, I wrote it down, a survivor warrior. You said, she shouldn't even have survived that fire. And she's also an amazing writer. She left all kinds of stuff for us. She was intelligent, wasn't she? Clearly a gift that passed on, my goodness, to her children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren. She had a full scholarship to the university after being in the top 10% in her high school class. She couldn't use it because she got pregnant. But she used it in her life and in her thinking and in her search to be whole. Christine's addiction was really rough on her kids and on Tom. It's important not to shortchange all the ways that it was hard on you. I'm so sorry about that. And I know she was deeply sorry, and she blamed herself mercilessly for that. You were only 16 and 17 years old when, after a legal case, you had an intervention. You went and talked to the judge. Holy cats. As a former youth director, I look at the strength of that and I think, wow, how to be a young man and woman well before your time, and to do it on behalf of your mother to help rescue her. Christine was spiritual. She loved these windows and all that's happening out there. I hope you've been watching. The spring birds are already sometimes moving around in this warmer weather. She said to her kids, "You need to figure out what you believe on your own. I'm not gonna force you." They tried out different churches, an experiment that wasn't perfect and that left some feelings of, where do I belong? It was true. Christine loved nature, gardening, poems, and writing. She loved her family. She loved her dog. Was his name really Boo Boo? Forrest. Forrest Gump. otherwise known as Boo Boo. Pretty good. She went on wellness retreats with horses. Despite or maybe because of the hard experience with her body and being impacted by the fire over almost 70% of her body, she was free-spirited about her body, her kids say. Tom, you told me you wonder if it was a kind of defiance or reclaiming of her bodily sense. How cool. I want to say, just give a nod to Jim McMahon, Papa, as you call him, now 92, not here today, but hopefully watching, who married her mother and adopted her. He was so kind to her, and she told stories of his putting cream moisturizer on her body when she was burned. Now remember, she was only 5 years old and she'd been in the hospital for 13 months, not touched, right? Imagine what it would mean to a child to be fathered in that way, to be loved that way. Her biological and adopted fathers were friends, also a neat example, Thomas Trost, and they hunted together. Christine's style was affectionate, exuberant, I would say. She kept striving in life. She made bad choices. She had some wrong paths, some paths that hurt her, as her kids put it. She blamed herself, as I said, but Tom said the key. But she was so resilient. She never gave herself enough credit for that, for being so resilient. I always knew my mom loved me. You were enough, weren't you? There was never any question about that. There were hard things, but she wanted what was best for us. She didn't always have the means to do what she wanted. Now, when you told that steak story, you told me she came home and said, steak or shrimp? And you chose shrimp. I'm sorry, steak. And you also told me how fruit was a treat to you. What a cool mom to protect her kids so fiercely. You, her children, were the focus of her love and of her healing. She adored her grandchildren and greats. Jacob, now 35 years old, her love for you was so great. She called you my gift of sobriety. She used the fact of your coming and your existence as the reason to be motivated to go sober. And she managed 35 years of sobriety. Not an easy thing. She did that so she could love you and help raise you. I hope that feels really good. Now, Christine was notorious for being late, but when she decided to stop dialysis, it was only one day before she went. She was just 97 pounds, which tells me she was dying already. She told Renee she didn't want to go to dialysis, and Tom confirmed she understood what that meant. She said, I don't want to do this anymore. She was talking hardly at all at that point. Maybe she was waiting for our permission, Tom thought. So many of you were around her just before she died. I don't know if I got the list right, but it included nieces, Elaine's daughter, Emily. She saw three siblings, her dad, her best friend. She had phone calls. She was with two of her sisters and Patty when she wanted to get up because she was talking. There was talking, combing of her hair, love and care, but she was miserable. Nobody then knew it would be the last time. Tom saw her and went out only minutes before she died. Larry, so faithfully present to her, stepped out for a cigarette and she died then. Now, I'm a hospice chaplain, and I have seen it happen many times that people choose the time of their going, that a person waits like that to slip away, and perhaps that's what she did. Either way, what a lovely way to go, isn't it? To be surrounded by your family who don't have a clue. It's the last time, you know, to be loved and cared for in that way. That's what meant the most for her. That was the ground of her being, was your love. Her whole life, she said she wasn't afraid to die. Tom wonders if that's possible for a living creature. And she told Renee, the only thing I'm scared of, the only thing is I won't see you and Tommy. She did look scared, you said, and worried. And she also, to her children, looked ready. She looked accepting. She finally took that step that she'd thought about so long. I hope now she knows fully and completely and without a shadow of fear that she is enough. She is loved just as she is. She is an imperfect but loving and beloved person. I hope the divine forces out there are healing her and setting her at peace. This is not a fairy story made up, polished about a perfect person in a perfect world doing perfect things. This is a story about a human being, one who suffered and struggled mightily, and who had the highest hopes as a parent, a grandma, great-grandma, friend, through extremely hard and harrowing work of sobriety and other troubles. She wanted to be there for each of you to express her deepest hopes. I hope you're hearing them today loud and clear. She understood her healing and her wholeness as related to her understanding of herself, her aspirations in finding the way in the world, and of finding her own relationship to you all and to God. "I am a child of the universe," was in a clipping she had. She knew she had to forgive herself and declare her inherent worthiness. "No matter what, I am enough." And it was hard. The trauma, the addiction, the anxiety, terrible fears. All those fears came out howling, didn't they? She struggled with them forever. But she knew she was resilient. She didn't give up on herself. She knew the fears and she knew the practices that were antidotes. Sobriety, curling up in her pink blanket, sitting in the sun, chicken noodle soup, the cheap kind, thinking, moving, crying, praying, even watching scary movies. Try it, it's therapeutic. And most of all, breathing. I hope we remember that wisdom that grounded her. Remember that wonderful list, and especially breathing. I'd like to invite you to take a few deep breaths right now. Just feel the goodness coming into your body, down into your belly. Take some breaths. Restorative breaths that bring you back to your body. Take a breath. Feel the miracle of being here alive, being here alive together. What an honor. In her honor, whenever things feel too hard or you feel overwhelmed or worried or anxious, stop, pause, and take a breath. Remember, you don't have to be perfect, much as you wish you could be, to be perfectly loved. Love is healing if only we lean toward it. Among her treasured papers, Christine saved a story by Temple Bailey called A Mother's Walk, honoring her wishes to transmit these many precious documents she left us. I'm going to read that to you in closing. A young mother set her foot on the path of life. She had a guide, and she said, "Is this the way?" "Yes, the way is hard. You will be old before you reach it, but the end will be better than the beginning." The young mother was happy. She could not believe anything could be better than these years. She played with her children and gathered flowers and bathed them in clear streams. The sun shone, and the young mother cried, "Nothing will ever be lovelier than my children." The night came and the storm and the path was dark. The kids shook with fear and cold, and the mother drew them close and covered them with her mantle. The children said, "We're not afraid, for you are near. No harm can come." In the morning, she was thrilled, but there was a hill ahead. The children climbed and grew weary. The mother was weary, but she said, "A little patience, we'll be there, we'll be there." So the children climbed, and when they reached the top, they said, "We couldn't have done it without you." The mother, when she laid down at night, looked at the stars and said, "This day is better than the last, for my children have learned fortitude in the face of hardness. Yesterday I gave them courage, today strength." And when the next day came, strange clouds darkened the earth. There were clouds of war and hate and evil, and the children groped and stumbled. The mother said, "Look up, lift your eyes to the light." And the children saw the everlasting glory above the clouds. It guided them. And that night she thought, this is the best day of all, for I have shown my children God. The days went and the weeks and months and years, and she grew old. She was bent, but her children were strong and they walked with courage. And when the way was rough, they lifted her, for she was light as a feather. At last they came to a hill, and beyond that they could see a shining road and golden gates flung wide. And she said, I have reached the end of my journey, and now I know the end is better than the beginning. My children can walk alone, and their children after them, and their grandchildren. And the children said, you will always walk with us, mother, even when you're gone through the gates. You will be here in our tears and in the foods we eat. They stood and watched her as she went on alone through the gates, and they said, we cannot see her, but she is still with us. A mother like ours is more than a memory. She is a living presence. Wow. The family has asked that we share a prayer, and it's a prayer that is a an interpretation, I would say, of a translation. And for a while it went around the internet saying it's the pre-Christian version because it comes right from the Aramaic of the Lord's Prayer. It's actually not that. It's an interpretation by a man named Neil Douglas Klotz. He was a scholar in spirituality and religious studies. And his translation opened up minds to a fresher love and a healing paradigm taught by Jesus. So we're going to read that today. I would ask you to put the pre-Christian in quotes in your bulletin. But he said, among other things, that the idea of one translation of this ancient text is suspect. It's a problem. And this is his interpretation of it. Would you please stand? We'll show the text up there. And we'll read this, an interpretation of the Lord's Prayer. Please join me. O cosmic birther of all radiance and vibration, soften the ground of our being and carve out a space within us where your presence can abide. Fill us with your creativity so that we may be empowered to bear the fruit of your mission. Let each of our actions bear fruit in accordance with our desire. Endow us with the wisdom to produce and share what each needs to grow and flourish. Untie the tangled threads of destiny that bind us, others from the entanglement of past mistakes. Do not let us be seduced by that which would divert us from our true purpose, but illuminate the opportunities of the present moment. For you are the ground and the fruitful vision, the birth, the power, and fulfillment, as all is gathered and made whole once again. And so it is. Please be seated. Singers? Oh, I'm sorry, Samantha.
Hi, so I apologize. I'm currently dealing with double ear infection, sinus infection, so my hearing is off. So I apologize if I'm horrible. My apologies. Grammy loved this song. She felt it was the only version that truly encapsulated what Somewhere Over the Rainbow and What a Wonderful World meant. She felt Izzy was a wonderful human being who brought love and light to the world, and she wanted love and light in the world everywhere. Again, I apologize. I will do my best.
Ooh, 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 ooh. So way up high.
once in a lullaby. Somewhere over the rainbow, bluebirds fly, and the dreams that you dreamed of, dreams really do come true. Ooh. Someday I'll wish upon a star, wake up where the clouds are far behind me, where trouble melts like lemon drops, high above the chimney tops, that's where you'll find me. Oh, somewhere over the rainbow, bluebirds fly, and the dream that you dare to, oh why can't I? Well, I see trees of green and red roses too. I'll watch them bloom for me and you, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Well, I see skies of blue and I see clouds of white, and the brightness of day highlight the dark, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people passing by. I see friends shaking hands saying, how do you do? They're really saying, I love you. Oh, I hear babies cry and I watch them grow. They'll learn much more than we'll know. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world, world. Someday I'll wish upon a star, wake up where the clouds are far behind me, where trouble melts like lemon drops, high above the chimney top, that's where you'll find me. Oh, somewhere over the rainbow, way up high, and the dream that you dare to, oh why can't I, oh, ooh, 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 yeah,
Please rise in body or spirit for the benediction. Beloveds, as we mourn the loss of Christine's physical presence, may you comfort one another with stories and with silent presence, knowing there is so much to remember and so much that lies beyond words. Make space for her to continue in death to bless you, as she did in life and in your lives together. Let it be that you rise and try and forgive and laugh in honor of those who have gone ahead and in honor of those you are here among, breathing together in gratitude and in wonder. Our closing hymn is in this teal hymnal, number 1064. It's written by a member of this congregation. I'll ask the family to stay, and afterwards, Mary will play some closing music as the family goes out first, please, and then they will greet you on the way out. So hymn number 20, I'm sorry, 1064, Blue Boat Home.